Hello guys, and welcome to another session of our online classes of film studies. These classes are being done because we are under lockdown. We all are staying at our home. I hope you're staying at home, staying safe, making yourself useful by doing these online classes, not just from me but from other lecturers also. There are so many MOOCs available. Take full benefit of them. EdX is there, Swayam is there, we have Coursera, so many MOOCs, Udemy. There are so many MOOCs which are free. You don't need to pay them. If you want to pay a certificate, you can do that, but go for these MOOCs. Add knowledge whenever you can. I just finished one MOOC a couple of days back. It was amazing. It was on negotiation skills, amazing stuff. You can go for that, or you can go for anything. There's photography, there's film study, there is a business, there's management, there's soft skills, hard skills, whatever you want to get there. So make sure that you are using this time to improve yourself. That is what is more important. Self-investment, self-improvement always goes for a long time. Also, a lot of confusion is there regarding when the lockdown is going to end, when is your exams. As usual, you can go and check the college website www.saintaloysius.edu.in, where you can find latest information about exams, timetables, class reopening, admissions, everything you can get on saintaloysius.edu.in. Some of the information is already there. Some of the information is going to come up soon. So keep checking the online website www.saintaloysius.edu.in. So without further ado, let us get into today's topic. And today's topic is a gentleman known as Bele Balas. And we're continuing our session on the key thinkers in film theory. Bele Balas, 1884 to 1949, roughly the same age, the same time frame as the previous video which we saw. That would be Sergei Eisenstein. Not as long life as Rudolf Arnheim, who almost lived the entire 20th century. Bele Balas is an important figure, even though he died before 1950. Very important figure. So this is a brief introduction about Bele Balas. Like I said, like I usually say, these videos are only there for introductory purposes. You need to go and read more about these thinkers, whether it's Bele Balas or whether it's André Bazin, Rudolf Arnheim, whoever we have taken in the past and whoever we are going to take in the future. Read more about them. This is just an introductory topic. So let's get into today's topic, that is Bele Balas, a brief introduction. Let's see who Bele Balas is. Bele Balas is actually a Hungarian film critic and an aesthetician, a writer and a poet. Aesthetics is, like we have discussed in the last lecture on Rudolf Arnheim, it is a beauty, art of beauty, how to look good. So you go and check out my video on Rudolf Arnheim to check what is aestheticism. It's there on the playlist and you can get it there. Now come back, you can see that Bele Balas was a Hungarian poet, he was a aesthetician, he's a writer, he was a film critic, very important film critic also, because he has given some of the most groundbreaking work on film aesthetics, right? The Visible Person, that's his first book in 1924, and Spirit of Film in 1930. These two, he has written other books also, but these are the books which are related to film theories and film studies, and we are going to be taking and seeing some of the key concepts which he has given in these two books. The Visible Person, 1924, and The Spirit of Film, in 1930. In 1945, he established the film aesthetics department at the Hungarian Academy of Dramatic Arts, and he also founded the Film Studies Institute. So very influential guy if you look at his portfolio. I'm giving just a brief introduction here about his achievements, only a few of which we can take in this online class, but read about him on his Wikipedia page. You can see that the guy was amazing when it comes to film theory and the influence which he had over subsequent contemporary as well as subsequent film theorists and film thinkers. Okay, so in 1945 he did that. In 1958, the Belabala's studio for young filmmakers was named after him, and so was a prize for filmmakers. This is in Hungary, because he was from a Hungarian, he was from Hungary. So this is basically from Hungary, but you can see that very influential person. He has a name, studio for filmmakers named after him. He has a national award named after him for filmmakers. So that itself shows what his influence might have been. So we'll look into what his influences have been. He was a proponent of formalist film theory. One of the few things which we had discussed in the very early part of film theory, film movement, was the formalist film theory. Remember the class on formalism and realism? If you don't, it's okay. I will tell you what, in brief, what is formalist film theory. Formalist film theory focuses on the formal or technical elements of a film. That is how the film looks, rather than what is in it. What is the story, or what is the content, or what is the message? How it is being shot, how it has been portrayed, is what the formalist film theory goes. So a lot of things goes in studying the formalism of a film, mainly lighting, scoring, that is the scoring of music, sound and set design, use of colors, shot composition, and of course editing. All these things go into making a movie look good. So formalist film theory is about the form rather than the content. So Hugo Munsterberg, Rudolf Arnheim, Sergei Eisenstein, and of course Belle-Velaz were proponents of formalist film theory. And we can see in the next video we talk about Siegfried Krakauer. He was a realist film theorist. Okay, so he based his theories on realism, which is the other end of formalism. The formalism is here, realism is here. These gentlemen said film should look good. Film should, the formalist element, it has to have fantasy, it has to have look, it has to be out of the box, it has to be more realistic, more than just realism. So you can remember from Hugo Munsterberg and Rudolf Arnheim, they were big proponents of how cinema can be an art form and not just record reality, just like it. Okay, that's what we had discussed about in the videos of Hugo Munsterberg, Rudolf Arnheim, and we also saw how Sergei Eisenstein based his cinema and his montage theory also on formalist film theory. Russian formalism is a movement. You can go and read about more to know more about the formalist film theory. Today it is a major theory of film study. So that's it about formalist film theory. So now we will get into the key concepts provided by Belle-Velaz in his two books, which we have mentioned in the first chapter, the first slide, sorry. Belle-Velaz's early works appeared in the period of accelerated technological development. So remember, we are talking about 1920s, 30s and 40s, especially 20s and 30s, when he was getting his foot into the industry. He could see that there was a lot of technological development happening across the world. We are not talking only about Hollywood. Remember, we had discussed earlier cinema, a lot of influence was being provided by the French, and of course America was playing its part, but Europe was equally in the forefront during the beginning time of film. In fact, Lumiere Brothers George Méliès, they were all European filmmakers, like we had discussed in the class. At this time, even his early works were appearing, Belle-Vilas saw a lot of accelerated technological development. Cinema was being, how would you put it? Cinema was being transformed every single day by something new or the other. What we take for granted today, like camera movements, camera angles, editing, 3D cinema, all those things were not there during the early days of Balazs's early works, right? So everything was coming up, new narrative cinema was coming. In 1914, we had The Birth of the Nation, which is generally considered as the birth of narrative cinema, long form also. So there's a lot of technological development going on in that time, especially in terms of the emergence of unchained cinema. Unchained cinema is something which is very common for us today, but it is not that very that common during Belle-Vilas's early period. This is 1920s, 1930s. Camera was still in the sense that it didn't move much. There was not many shots, zooms, not many pans, not many tilts. Unchained camera is when the camera is unchained from its stationary position and it starts moving around. So shots from camera in motion, enabling to use pan shots, tracking shots, tilts, crane shots, etc. These are known as unchained cinema, or sorry, unchained camera. And this was something which was very new technological development, something new which came up during the early periods of Belle-Vilas's early works. Okay, something else was experiments with stereoscopic film color. That is, a stereoscopic cinema is the predecessor of what we now know as 3D cinema, and of course, widescreen. That is, going 70 mm, 35 mm. It's going widescreen cinema. Going widescreen, and of course the coming of sound. Not many people at that time liked sound because they thought sound would get back cinema back into being a theater or back to being reality. It will stop being a work of art. Most of them have been thankfully proved wrong of their fears. So these are the things which we should keep in mind about the time period when Belle-Vilas started analyzing films, started analyzing the film industry, the technological developments which were going on. So keep in mind these things when we move forward and look at the key concepts of Belle-Vilas. Right? He said that it's an outcome of constant struggle between, that's what his position, an outcome of constant struggle between the tendency to explore the spiritual dimension of the new art, that is cinema, the new art which we are talking about is cinema, and to explain its core features from a technical point of view. If you look at these two points, you can see that that's what Belle-Vilas was trying to do. His theory, his output was a constant, was an outcome of a constant struggle. He was between deciding whether to explore the spiritual dimension of the new art or whether he wanted to explain the score features from a technical point of view. Both are different. So he conceived his theory to be, or theory in general, to be a developing system. He never said that his theory, or any theory for that matter, as long as it's related to film or cinema, was completely developed. He said that it is still a developing systems, and the assumptions may be open for correction, maybe they are wrong. Since he said the subject, that is the cinema, is also a developing system, so new things which might come up can affect building of theory, and it can affect the development of theory also. So he said that everything is developing, so let us see how it goes, and we'll develop our theories and we'll develop cinematic concepts, cinematic criticism as and when cinema goes forward. We'll take everything into consideration and then we will build our theory. That was his way of looking at things. We'll now look at something which is very unique to Bele Ballas, and that's his influence of gestalt psychology on him. The key term, of course, in Bele Ballas's influence was gestalt. According to the Merriam-Webster dictionary, the definition of gestalt is this: it's something is made up of many parts, yet somehow it's more than or different from the combination of its parts. That is, many a particular thing, it can be a painting, it can be a car, it can be a film, it has many different layers, many different parts, many different components, and each of them have their own work. And separately, if you take them, they have their importance, but when they all combine together, the result is much more than just all the parts put together. There is much more benefits in putting all together. This creates gestalt. The moving image, due to montage, he said, applying this to cinema can result in gestalt. What is cinema? Lot of different parts are put together, but the end product cannot be called as a combination of shots. It cannot be called a combination of shots plus music or a combination of actors. It is much more than that. It is a product which can influence the people. It's a product which can touch the people where something else might not touch. So the moving image, because of montage, can result in gestalt. The entire meaning transcends the visible because it's the product of observation and imagination of the people. Okay, so film was a most advanced achievement of modern art. That's what Bele Ballas believed. He believed that the viewer is confronted with inward movements expressed in facial expressions that change before his or her very eyes. We are talking about a person sitting in the cinema theater and watching a film going on. It can still be considered that we are looking at a smartphone and with our Netflix going on, or we can see that we are having our laptop open and some Korean drama is going on. Everything is a viewer, everywhere you can see that the viewer is confronted with inward movements expressed in facial expression that change before his very eyes, his or her very eyes. Ballas's theory comes close to the notion that the world itself is kind of a meta film. Whatever is going on around us is like a meta film, right? And each take is a fragment of overall movement that encompasses everything. Beautiful thought if you look at it, right? Ballas expected an overwhelming cultural shift to result from cinema. He didn't want cinema, or he didn't look at cinema only as a form of entertainment or as a form of recording reality or recording physical objects. He expected a overwhelming cultural shift to result from cinema. He thought it would be able to change the face of nearly everything in a profound manner. Was he successful? Maybe he was, maybe he was not. But this becomes evident if one compares the main feature, this is what he said, with the culture that has been shaped by books and rational discourse. The discovery of printing has gradually rendered the human face ineligible. Now, what he says basically here, and this is taken from his book, The Invisible Man, what he says basically, what he means here is that before the advent of books, the human face was there right in front of the people. But once books started coming, we had to read the description of the person's face or the person's expressions or the person's non-expressions. Cinema got the person back by putting the person's face, making her invisible in front of the screen. Theatre did that, but theatre did on a very smaller scale. Bele Ballas said that cinema, and this is the cultural shift he was looking for, he said cinema is something which liberates a human being from their bondages, because now we can see humans right in front of the cinema. But in a book, we are just able to read that, okay, he frowned. But we can, in the cinema, we can actually see the person frowning. So the discovery of printing has gradually rendered human face ineligible. Cinema brings the human face back to the forefront by putting the humans on the screen and on the camera. Okay, crucial innovation that sets cinema apart from stage drama. So we were discussing about drama, how it's different. So he said that a very crucial innovation which sets cinema apart from stage drama, theater drama, is the variance of viewpoints. Now, what does this variance of viewpoint mean? Imagine you're sitting in a theater. You're sitting front row, third row from the front on the left side. You have one view which is to the theater like this. But in cinema, imagine if you're sitting in the same position, but you have variance of viewpoints because the camera. Yes, the camera can move on your behalf. Stage people cannot move on your behalf. They can move around the stage, but if you want to look at a person's close-up, you have to go on the stage and see their expressions. But on cinema, you can just sit there and see it. So a person's expression can be seen from a mid shot, a close up, or a wide shot. That's what we call variance of viewpoint. That's what Balabala is called, variance of viewpoints. And that is what separated cinema from theater, according to Balabala. He was very partial and very fond of promoting the close-up. One thing which is Balabala's is always associated with is the close-up. The way he studied the close-up, the way he said, he discussed the importance of close-up in cinema, and he said that close-up is inserted to intensify viewers' empathetic understanding, show empathy towards the actors. It cannot be possible on the stage, right? You have to look from one view, one side, person. But from the same seat in a cinema theater, you can look at the person from a close-up, from a wide angle, from a long shot, over-the-top shot. Variants. There's so many variants of viewpoints which is given to the viewer, especially the close-up. Okay, Balas considered the close-up to be the cornerstone of every genuine film, the core feature of the new art. He believed that close-up was something which was inherent, which is very different from every other art form. Photography had close-up, but there was no moving image. Painting had close-up, but again, there was no moving image. Cinema had close-up plus moving image. So that made cinema much different from the other forms of art, according to Balabala. He sees cinema means to establish a visual culture which transcends the boundaries of traditional aesthetics. That is, they had a particular way of looking at beauty, particular way of looking at art during their time. He thought cinema is going to change all those things and bring new forms of aesthetics, new forms of beauty, new standards of beauty, new standards of judgment regarding art and beauty. And he saw cinema as a means to establish a visual culture which transcends the boundaries of traditional aesthetics. Of course, sound was not very popular at that time, so it was more of a visual culture. Balas also proposed to study the forms of cinema by what he considered to be marginal genres. Genres are, like we have discussed, various types of movies, like we can call them categories of movies. They share a same type of characteristics. So if you see a lot of action happening in a movie, you can call that as an action genre. Or if there's a lot of drama going on, you can call that as a drama movie. If you can see non-human beings being animated, you can call that animation genre. Here, what does he mean by marginal genre? Marginal genre means those types of movies which are not in the mainstream. They are outside the mainstream. They are on the margins of the mainstream. He said we need to study the forms of cinema by examining what he considers to be marginal genre. You can look at marginal genres concept like this, like two ends of something, there's something in between. He said ignore whatever types of movies are in between. It's like, let's go and check out what kind of movies is here and what kind of movies are here. And he hoped that by looking at its extremes, he would be able to see the laws and rules of cinematic shape. For Ballas, the outer regions of cinema, not the middle one, now had been colorized on one side by the avant-garde or abstract film, which is like totally artistic, devoid of any kind of story. Like if you go and watch, I have told you about Louis Bunuel, Asia Andalou in, I think it was in the Latin cinema video, Louis Bunuel. It's so beautiful movie, but it's devoid of any kind of story. So abstract film, there's one side. And on the other hand, it's pure documentary. It's like pure, how do you put it? Pure realism. So in this case, you can see George Méliès' Trip to the Moon neither falls here because it had a story. It had fantastic elements, but it still had a narrative story. And neither was it like Lumiere Brothers' train, coming arrival of the train, pure documentary type. So George Méliès and most of the movies, Shole, Manichitthitharu, Kannada movies, most of them come here. The marginal movies are either very abstract movies, which are kind of experimental movies, you can call them. And on the other side, we have pure documentary. So these are the two things which he said are marginal genres coming outside. A pure documentary is trying to avoid a particular story, loses its voice entirely and is dumb. Ballas said this, not me. It is like the uncarved rock on the hillside. It's rude and virtually meaningless. Again, Ballas said this. Okay. On the other hand, the pure abstract films on the other side of the continuum has gone beyond story in its search for absolute share, thereby losing touch with reality it should interpret. So he said these two things can be studied and seen and understood, and these things, with the help of these two things, we can understand what is in the middle, which is most of the movies which are created. So in conclusion, we have already reached the conclusion of this class. It's kind of almost half an hour since we have begun this session. So in conclusion, we can say that Ballas's vision of film technique was completely based on the belief that films are not pictures of reality, but rather the humanization of nature. So he is more of a formalist, which we have discussed. He didn't believe that films should advocate or capture or record reality. He said humanization of nature is required, which takes cinema into the realms of formalism, right? Most of Bazin's idea about film technique correspond quite closely to Arnheim's, for both feel that all vision is formative. Look at Arnheim, what he said. Even he said films should be considered as a form of art. They should be given the status of art. They should not be used, or they should not be considered as something which records reality. So he was also formalist in that sense. But unlike Arnheim, an ardent proponent of new cinematic inventions, Arnheim was very much in favor of cinematic inventions. He insisted, that is, Ballas insisted that they should be formative rather than their realistic potential. He was not very much in favor of innovations, not much in invention, as much as Rudolf Arnheim. He was to a certain extent, but not as open-minded as Rudolf Arnheim when it came to cinematic inventions. Okay, so what else do we know about Bale Ballas? Unquestionably, he is the poet of close-up. One thing always associated with Bale Ballas is the work he has done on close-up. If you look at Sergei Eisenstein, his work on the montage, he's always associated with Battleship Potemkin. Same way, Ballas is the poet of the close-up. The way he has worked extensively on close-up, the technique of close-up, its power to him was infinitely moving, infinitely revealing. He was very much impressed by the way cinema used close-up, and he compared the film to a microscope capable of revealing hidden world of both nature and the psyche, which is quite a normal thing to consider now in April 2020, but in 1920s, 1930s, 80, 90 years back, this was something new concept. So that's it about Rudolf Arnheim, Bale Ballas, and I hope you have enjoyed today's lecture. Short one compared to the others. Yes, it's only 31 minutes. Some others are 37 minutes. So thank you for listening, and read more about Bale Ballas. Every video, like I said, please go and read more. Don't depend only on my videos here. Read more. This is just an introduction for Bale Ballas. So thank you for listening, and I hope you will follow all the coronavirus related safety related materials, measures. Follow these steps, stay inside, stay safe, and keep checking our website for new information, saintaloysius.edu.in, and I hope to see you soon. Hopefully we'll all see each other, and we'll conduct our exams, and we'll get into the next year as quickly as possible. So thanks a lot for watching. Stay safe.